Hey there, Jeff Lerner here, and in this video, we are going to be looking at the top three reasons that businesses fail. You might have read the statistics that well over 50% of businesses fail within the first few years. Actual new businesses, the statistics are particularly bleak on likelihood of success. What I have found is that if you put certain factors in place, certain variables that you control, you can dramatically increase the likelihood of your business succeeding. I have failed at many businesses and succeeded at just enough to really dramatically change the quality of my life. And so I want to talk to you about the top three reasons that businesses fail. You got your paperwork together, you got your idea together, you got your business plan together, and you're ready to embark on starting the business that is going to change the course of your life and change the world and do all these amazing things. And yet you realize that statistically you are embarking on something that is likely not to go the way that you planned. Statistics on starting businesses are even worse than statistics on starting marriages. But in a lot of ways, they're similar things where nowadays, you know, the majority of marriages end in divorce, the majority of businesses end in closure, but everybody starts with this sort of not only just enthusiasm and a sense of possibility, but I think almost willful disbelief or even willful ignorance about how things could go and the fact that in all likelihood, they aren't going to go that well, or they're certainly not going to go according to plan. This isn't like one of the three reasons businesses fail, but this is just sort of my own observation. Is that like step one of succeeding in business is to realize out of the gate that it's going to be harder than you think. It's going to require more time than you think. It's going to require more money than you think. And most of all, it's just going to require more drive, more raw energy and heat and intensity than you think or than you could possibly imagine. Frankly, to the point where, and maybe it's good that we're a little bit ignorant or in sort of denial about this going in to where, frankly, here's my experience of succeeding in some businesses and really succeeding well and then obviously failing in quite a few businesses. Very often, I think if you actually knew what it was going to take to make your business successful, you might not start the business. So in that sense, maybe it's good that we don't fully appreciate how hard it's going to be. But I also think that by fully realizing and being aware of how hard it's going to be, we do dramatically increase the likelihood that the business itself is going to succeed. And so in that sense, it's probably not a good idea to be naive going in. But one of the things I mentioned is that your business is going to take more money than you tend to think, and that is actually the number one reason that businesses fail is because they are undercapitalized. You know, I always tell people, you know, I talk to a lot of people that are getting ready to or looking at starting a business or want to build a second income or a side hustle, we call it whatever, and I say, you're going to have to invest. You're going to have to invest money, you're going to have to invest time. There's no shortcut to say, how can I invest neither? But the relationship, like a lot of things in life, is a whole lot of time initially in the early goings generates very little money. But a decent amount of money, not a huge amount of money, but a little bit of money can shortcut a whole lot of time. In other words, the relationship is a lot of time equals a little bit of money. And when you're getting started in a business, being able to put a little bit of money here and there can save you a whole lot of time here and there. And if you don't have the money to put in, just be aware, you're gonna have to put in a whole lot of time. The ratio is kind of imbalanced over the life course of a business that when you start, smaller amounts of money correlate to much larger amounts of time, whichever comes first, whether you're putting in a lot of time to make a little bit of money or you're putting in a little bit of money to save a lot of time, that's the nature of a business in the early goings. As your business grows, it actually kind of starts to flip as the systems mature and the processes evolve and you get some momentum and you get some reputation and you get some history and you get repeat customers and you just kind of get further down the road. Now you can do little things that take a little bit of time to generate a lot more money. On the flip side, every moment in the business tends to get more expensive too. So the ratio between time and money kind of flips over the life course of a business. One of the interesting phenomenon of business. But what it means is in the early goings, if you don't have a lot of time to invest, you need to at least have some money to invest. And most businesses fail. The number one reason most businesses fail is that they just simply run out of money. You could argue that, you know, that was just inevitably, or, you know, more money would have just delayed failure. You'd be throwing good money after bad. But the fact is, most businesses adjusted for an infinite timeline eventually will work. If you had unlimited time and unlimited energy to give a business and just enough money to keep that effort, to sustain that effort, eventually most businesses would work. Usually the business fails because it's like a plane. You literally have only X amount of runway to get the plane off the ground. Get on top of your game and then start the business that's going to be life defining for you. I think that's one of the things that so many people struggle with a business, and is there, it's, and it's called the XY problem. It's actually, if you can Google XY problem, it's like a real subject in logic and management theory, where they say, I want to use X to solve Y, or I guess you can flip the variables around and say, how can I solve X problem by use of Y? And a lot of times people are trying to solve X problem in their life, not enough money, not enough fulfillment, not enough, you know, whatever, passion, or they're trying to please their parents or whatever it is. And so they're trying to solve it with Y, which is, I need to start a business. I need to be successful. I need to make money. I need to sell products. I need to learn marketing. I need to whatever. I need to learn sales. And Y isn't actually the solution for X. A lot of times the solution is stabilize your life and build the skills. And that's actually how was my third reason on my list, but it was a lack of relevant skills is why businesses fail. And a lot of times you have businesses that can succeed up to a certain point because you have a really excited person, really inspired leader, person, the driver of the business, who maybe you're good at selling, maybe you're good at providing the service, maybe you're good at delivering on whatever the business does, but then it gets time to actually grow the business. Now you need, you know, you're trying to hire, you're trying to train, you're trying to delegate and offload responsibilities from yourself to, you know, employees. Maybe you're having to deal with customer service. Maybe you're having to deal with accounting. Maybe you're having to deal with a tax issue, whatever. You know, a lot of times you run up against these skills that have nothing to do with the core product or service of the business and everything to do with actually running a business. And very often that can be the undoing of the business, is that it's led by a person who's a skilled technician or a skilled service provider at whatever the business does, but you're not actually skilled at running a business. Now, there's a great book called Rocket Fuel that I suggest you read if you have any aspirations to starting a business. It was a huge breakthrough book for me that basically breaks the leadership skills of business operations into a visionary and integrator bucket. So you have your visionary buckets, which are about leadership, which are about sales, which are about messaging, which are about product knowledge to some degree. And then you have your integrator bucket of skills, which are about making the systems flow, creating infrastructure, operationalizing, creating processes, documenting processes, and basically knowing how to run a business. And they are two very often dramatically different skill sets. And this correlates to the first point. Part of having like life stability is it's not enough to just say, okay, well, I've got some time and I know how to do a thing. Like, let's say your thing is, you know how to build cabinets. And you're like, well, I've got some time. I got 20 hours a week. I can build cabinets. And I love building cabinets and I'm good at building cabinets. Okay, so let me go out and sell this service, right? And do this for people for money. What a lot of people fail to account for is that you're gonna get to a point where there's a whole other job that needs to be done that's the running of the business. Where it's not enough to just have enough time and to have the expertise to build cabinets. You've got to have additional time where you can learn and become proficient at the parts of that go into actually running the business and scaling the business, unless you just want it to be a hobby. And the goal of business, this is, you know, not to veer off track, but in my training company, Entre, one of the core values that we talk about is that the first goal of business is profit. And when you're trying to grow profitability of a business, part of operating a business successfully is having a core belief that the point of a business is to grow the business. And you're going to run up against a place where if you don't have your life in good enough order and you haven't, you know, partitioned the time and the energy and the mental energy to acquiring the skills and or having enough equity or enough profit or enough cash flow to be able to bring in an integration partner, somebody who can help you with that stuff, then you're going to bump up against a ceiling in a business. And that's, again, I would say that's probably the second reason I see businesses fail is that you have a tradesperson or a service provider or a product enthusiast or product expert who's not also proficient at running a business. And so the business becomes unmanageable. The third reason that businesses fail is when you have people that are overly focused on the service or product itself and that underemphasize the marketing and sales aspect. And this happens a lot of times with people that are experts at a thing, is that they'll get so deep in the expertise of the thing. And when they try to sell the thing, they talk about all the features and all the aspects of the thing or the service or whatever they do, that they fail to think and learn to speak in terms of their customer. Because consumers speak a very different language than experts in whatever's being sold. For, you know, as an example, for me, I'm very good at digital marketing. I'm very good at internet-based business. And I have a lot of people that want to learn internet-based business. But I have had to really, really retrain myself in talking about internet-based business, not to get into the weeds talking about internet-based business. Because I think internet-based business is so cool. I like to geek out on algorithms and analytics and data and metrics and you know, technical shortcuts and hacks and all this stuff. When in reality, people that don't have that natural aptitude or, you know, haven't spent the time, they need to constantly be brought back to the core messaging, the core values, the core benefits of this type of business. And it's just two completely different conversations. And one of them is great to have once you're delivering the product or delivering the service or delivering the training or whatever it is. But when you're selling the service, you have to have a different conversation. Dentists, you want to be a good dentist? Don't talk about drills. Talk about smiles. You know, I remember coaching a dentist once and saying, you're not a dentist. You're a marketer of dental services. And you happen to provide dental services on the back end as fulfillment. And he was like, what? I'm like, no, if you want to be a better dentist, you need to be better at selling dentistry. And selling dentistry is about the smile. What's it going to do for you? It's not about the drill. Even though your job day to day and the work that you do is about drilling and scraping and cleaning and cutting and whatever, you need to talk about smiling. That's how you say it. It's, again, two different conversations. And a lack of appreciation for that from the technician or service provider, I would say, is the third reason that many businesses either fail or just actually fail to launch in the first place. So I hope that's beneficial for you. If you like the direction of this conversation and you're like, well, that all sounds great. It would all be a lot easier if I had some, you know, maybe some extra money coming in and certainly some guidance on how to not be a business that fails. Well, I think you might love a lot of the rest of what my channel is all about. In fact, what I'm all about, my whole life is basically dedicated to helping people build the businesses, leverage the modern economy and the new sort of digital paradigm of the world to create, you know, passive cash flow and build a business that can fund your awesome life and let you do all these awesome great things. And that's really what every video on my channel is geared around. So I will invite you to subscribe to my channel and make sure you click the little bell so you get notified as new videos come out and just put your learning hat on, embrace the possibilities for your life. Again, that's what my channel is all about. That's what my business, my training company is all about. There's some links below that can not only link you with more videos, it can teach you about this stuff, but also give you some opportunities if you'd like to get out there and start trying to generate, you know, additional resources for yourself. But again, my invitation to you is just to subscribe and become a fan of what I believe is the awesome life that you are intended for and that I'm committed to teaching you more about how to achieve. So thanks for your time. Catch you on the next video.